final resting place? 6 months later, John Carroll Power was still waiting for directions from his bosses about what to do with Lincoln's coffin. It was still sitting there on the damp labyrinth floor. In the summer of 1877, workers came to renovate one of the monument's walls. That meant going into the labyrinth, and Power realized that workmen would certainly notice the coffin. Instead of having them stumble upon it, he decided to tell them it was there and who was in it. Less than 2 days later, Power overheard people in Springfield swapping the latest rumor. Lincoln's body was sitting in the dirt under a stack of rotting lumber. Horrified, Power rushed to John Stewart of the Monument Association to discuss the crisis. Stewart was no help. He and the other elderly association members just couldn't face going back into that suffocating space and hauling that heavy coffin again, especially not in summer. All Power could do was hope the rumors would die down. Patrick Jarrell traveled to Joliet on May 22, 1878, the day Jack Hughes and Terrence Mullen were due to get out of prison. While at the state pen, Terrell stopped in to see Ben Boyd. In the 2.5 years since Boyd's arrest, he and Terrell had become friendly. Boyd even offered his former nemesis occasional advice on catching conny men. Terrell then waited outside the main door of the prison. At 1 p.m., Hughes walked out a free man, or so he thought, but Terrell grabbed his arm and slapped handcuffs on his wrists. "I informed Jack that there was another case against him," Terrell reported, "that he would have to come to Chicago." Hughes was still facing charges for passing fake money. Remember, he'd been a wanted man even before the Lincoln job disaster. Now Terrell hauled him to Chicago, and a judge sent him right back to the Illinois State Penitentiary, this time for 3 years of hard labor. Mullen, meanwhile, returned to Chicago only to find that while he was in jail, Big Jim Kennelly had sold the hub and disappeared with the money. Shortly after midnight on November 7, 1878, a gang of body snatchers snuck into a gated cemetery in New York City and pried up the stone slab above the burial vault of a wealthy merchant named Alexander Stewart. The men climbed down into the vault, cracked open Stewart's casket, shoved the rotting body into a bag, and hurried off. The gang contacted Stewart's family and demanded a $250,000 ransom for the dead man's remains. The story was huge news around the country and soon showed up in the Springfield papers, reminding everyone of the attempt to steal Lincoln. "It appeared to me," Power recalled, "as though half the people of Springfield accosted me on the street or came to the monument and inquired if the body of Lincoln was safe. I did not think it was, but evaded their questions as well as I could." Again, Powers begged members of the Monument Association for help. Again, they said they were too old. The casket was too heavy. It was too hot down there. Power was done waiting. Acting on his own, he recruited 5 trustworthy young men. When they met him at the monument on the night of November 18th, Power handed out shovels and lanterns and led the way through Monument Hall into the labyrinth. They dug a hole and placed Lincoln's coffin at the bottom. 3 nights later, Power was finally beginning to relax when he got another shock. He was home after work, going through his mail, and came to a strange postcard. The short message read, "Be careful. Do not be alone, particularly Thursday night, November 21st. The note was signed only with the letter C. It had been sent from Chicago. Panic swept over Power again. It was the night of November 21st. He thought about rushing back to the monument, but it was too late, and he was scared to go alone. "Little sleep came to my eyes that night," he said. Early next morning, he hurried into the labyrinth. There were no footsteps, no signs anyone had tried to break in. All was safe, he reported. Who sent that postcard? What did it mean? Power never found out, and the mystery haunted him. Is there real danger? He wondered. Is there another scheme to capture the remains of Lincoln? Or is someone trying to play a joke? Unable to face this fear alone, Power talked to the men who had helped him bury Lincoln's coffin. Together, they agreed to form a secret organization with just one mission: protect Lincoln's body. They called themselves the Lincoln Guard of Honor. "We were never bound by any oath," Power said of the guard, "but something much stronger, our own sense of honor." In March 1880, Terrence Mullen was arrested for passing counterfeit bills in St. Louis. Terrell rushed to the jail, eager to talk with the conny man. Just as he'd hoped, Mullen was furious with Big Jim Kennelly and agreed to talk. acting on Mullen's information, Secret Service agents caught Kennelly with a stash of bogus $10 bills in his possession. A judge gave him 2 years in prison. Louis Swiegels may have helped save Lincoln's body, but he just couldn't stay clean. In one of his daily reports from 1880, Terrell mentioned that Swiegels was back behind bars, doing 12 years in Joliet for burglary. What about Boyd's brother-in-law, Pete McCartney, the conning man who prided himself on wriggling out of any trap? His luck ran out too. McCartney was nabbed in Indiana shoving fake 20s. He tried to bribe the cops with $1,500 in real money, but they hauled him off to jail. At trial, McCartney promised to change his ways, but the judge wasn't buying it. "There is little hope for reform," the judge told McCartney. "It is my duty to sentence you to 15 years at hard labor in the state prison." This time, McCartney served every day of his sentence. Mary Lincoln died on July 16, 1882. Her coffin was placed in the catacomb at the Lincoln Monument, next to the marble sarcophagus that everyone assumed held Abraham Lincoln's remains. Robert Lincoln knew the box was empty and knew his mother wanted to be buried beside her husband. So, late one night, Power and the other members of the Lincoln Guard of Honor carried Mary into the labyrinth, dug a hole, and set her down next to Abe. "I cannot adequately thank you," Robert wrote to the guard. "I think it will be best that no change should be made for a long time to come." But the story wasn't over. The rumors never faded. People continued whispering that Lincoln wasn't actually in his marble sarcophagus. Almost every day, Power faced the same question from tourists. Was the body in the box, or wasn't it? "We put it back there the second day after the attempt to steal it," Power always said, and that was strictly true. He just didn't mention that they'd taken it back out again. When people pestered him for details, Powers would say, "I suppose you wish to know if there is not further danger. If so, I can assure you that it is absolutely safe." If they asked more questions about the body, Power cut them off. And that was the end of the discussion. Power refused to say more. He insisted that the body was safe, and he knew in his heart it wasn't. Nothing but door locks and a few inches of dirt stood between Lincoln and a new team of body snatchers. After several more years of pleading with the Monument Association, Power finally convinced the members it was time for a permanent solution. Workers pulled up the tiles of the catacomb floor and dug a deep hole. On the morning of April 14, 1887, members of the Monument Association and Guard of Honor gathered at the monument. A Springfield plumber named Leon Hopkins was there too, though he didn't know why he'd been asked to come. "I guess we might as well go to work," Power said. The men carried the two bodies out of the labyrinth and set them down in Memorial Hall. Before they placed the coffins in the new hole, there was one last piece of business. Crazy rumors about the true whereabouts of Lincoln's remain had to be put to rest once and for all. "After so many changes," Power explained, "it was indispensably necessary to identify the body of the president." The lid of Lincoln's wooden coffin was lifted. Then Leon Hopkins found out why he was there. He was called forward and told to carefully cut open the inner lead coffin. Hopkins did this, gently bending back a flap of the soft metal above Lincoln's head. Sunlight slanted through the open door into the coffin. Everyone pushed forward to look. Of the 18 or 19 persons present, nearly all had personally seen the president in life, Power reported. There was not one who expressed the slightest doubt that he was looking at the features of the beloved president. "The remains were somewhat shrunken," added the Monument Association members in a signed statement, "but the features were quite natural, and we could readily recognize them as the features of the former illustrious president of our nation and our former friend and fellow citizen." Hopkins then bent the lead back into place and soldered the seams to make them airtight. The two coffins were carried around the monument to the catacomb and lowered into the new hole. Then workers poured in 4 feet of concrete, and when it hardened, laid the marble tiles back down just as they had been before. A very relieved Power could finally report that Lincoln's body was safe. After serving his 10 years, Ben Boyd was released from prison and went back to work as an engraver, this time doing perfectly legal work at a factory. "He has squared it," reported the Chicago Tribune. "He is a living personification of what a man can do if he will to regain a footing in society and make an honest living." Secret Service Chief James Brooks was impressed. Boyd took his medicine manfully and never whimpered. John Carroll Power stayed on as a custodian at the Lincoln Monument. In his spare time, he wrote History of an Attempt to Steal the Body of Abraham Lincoln, the first book about this story, and the only one by an eyewitness. He died in 1894 at age 74 and was buried in Oak Ridge Cemetery, very close to the monument he guarded for 20 years. Patrick Terrell served in the Secret Service until his retirement in 1899. Nothing is known about how he spent the next 21 years, but he lived until 1920. He died at age 89 and it was buried in Chicago. Incredibly, Abraham Lincoln's body was not done moving. By 1900, the poorly built Lincoln Monument was starting to collapse. Before the foundation could be rebuilt, the bodies of Lincoln and his family had to be safely removed. Workers first carried out the coffins of Lincoln's three sons. Then they cracked through the concrete above Abraham's and Mary's coffins. All five bodies were locked in a temporary vault near the monument until the renovations were complete. In April 1901, they were returned to the catacomb. Mary and the boys were sealed in crypts in the catacomb wall. Abraham was placed back into the white marble sarcophagus that held his body at the time of the robbery. Robert Lincoln came to take a look. He couldn't believe his eyes. After everything that had happened, his father's body was sitting there above ground exactly where it had been in 1876. He ordered a new hole dug in the catacomb. He wanted it 10 feet deep, and he wanted a steel cage set inside. On September 26, 1901, surviving members of the Guard of Honor gathered to move Lincoln's casket one last time. As soon as they got there, the men began to argue. Should they have one last look in the coffin, just to make absolutely sure Lincoln was still in there? Robert had specifically told them not to open the casket. They decided to anyway. Once again, they sent for Leon Hopkins, the plumber. An honor guard member named Joseph Lindley also telephoned the school of his 13-year-old son, Fleetwood, and talked with Fleetwood's teacher. The teacher told Fleetwood to race out to the Lincoln Monument right away. The boy wasn't sure what the hurry was, but he hopped on his bicycle, sped to the monument, pedaled up to Memorial Hall, pushed his bike inside, and leaned it against the wall. Someone shut the door behind Fleetwood. The room darkened. A single electric lamp threw a flood of light on the casket, which rested on two sawhorses. People stopped talking as Leon Hopkins stepped forward with a blowtorch. He began cutting open the lead, just as he had done 14 years before. Fleetwood crowded in for a closer look. He had only seen Lincoln in photographs, but when the casket was opened, he recognized the famous man immediately. His face was chalky white. Fleetwood would never forget. His clothes were mildewed. "He looked just like a statue of himself lying there," said another witness. Everyone agreed. This was Abraham Lincoln. Hopkins pushed the lead flap back into place. "I watched the shadow of the lid fall across Lincoln's face," recalled Guard of Honor member B.H. Monroe. "That face disappeared from mortal view forever." Fleetwood lifted one of the leather straps attached to the coffin and helped lower Lincoln's body into the steel cage, sitting inside the 10-foot hole in the catacomb floor. The cage was locked, and workers then began pouring in tons of wet concrete. As the concrete slowly dried, the body of Abraham Lincoln was sealed inside a massive rock-hard block. It's still there. Body Snatcher Bonus Section. We'll never know what body snatching stories Sweagles told Mullen and Hughes during their meeting at the Hub, described on page 85. But given his criminal past and shady friends, Sweagles may well have known of some of the more famous ghouls of the Midwest. Actually, body snatchers didn't like to be called ghouls. They preferred to be known as resurrectionists. Sweagles may have spoken fondly of the notorious William Cunningham, who worked the bone orchards in and around Cincinnati. Cunningham was a wagon driver by day. At night, he dug up dead people. He had the whole thing down to a science. First, he dug a small hole, just 2 feet by two, right above the coffin. He broke open the box and slid hooks under the fresh corpse's arms. Using ropes and brute force, he then hauled the body out of its box and up to the surface. Cunningham stripped off the stiff's fancy burial outfit and dressed it in well-worn everyday clothes. Then he sat the cold body next to him in his wagon and drove from the cemetery toward one of the city's medical colleges. A doctor who occasionally bought bodies from Cunningham recalled seeing the body snatcher returning from one of these late night trips. "There was a corpse sitting in the buggy on the seat beside him," the doctor said. "The corpse was dressed up in an old coat, vest, and hat." Cunny held the reins in his right hand while he studied the corpse with his left arm around the waist of his silent companion. "It didn't look quite right," Cunningham knew. So whenever someone walked by on the street, Cunningham turned angrily to his passenger, slapped him on the cheek. "Sit up," he shouted. "This is the last time I'm going to take you home when you get drunk. The idea of a man with a family disgracing himself this way." Cunningham was shot a couple of times by angry relatives of the dead, but that didn't slow him down much. He dug up and sold so many corpses, he became known as the Prince of the Ghouls. Shortly before his own death in 1871, Cunningham sold his own body to the Medical College of Ohio for $5. Then there was Dr. Joseph Nash McDowell, one of the most respected experts on human anatomy in the Midwest. When McDowell wanted a body, he cut out the middlemen. Instead of paying a resurrectionist, he recruited a few medical students and they did the jobs themselves. One day, McDowell learned about an especially interesting corpse, that of a girl who just died of a rare disease. Desperate to dissect and study the body, the doctor and two students dug it up and snuck it back to their school. But the girl's family immediately discovered the theft. A bunch of them grabbed guns and headed for McDowell's lab. McDowell was determined not to lose that corpse. He sprinted into his dark dissecting room with a lantern in his hand, lifted the light body with his other hand, and headed for the stairs. "I had ascended one flight of stairs when out went my lamp," McDowell recalled. "I laid down the corpse and restruck a light. I then picked up the body when out went my light again. I felt for another match in my pocket." Finally, stashing the body in the attic, the doctor raced down the dark stairs. As he passed a window, he heard two men talking on the street below. One had a shotgun, he remembered, the other a revolver. Just as McDowell reached the door of his dissecting room, someone lit a lantern at the bottom of the stairwell. Five or six armed men started up the stairs. McDowell darted into the room and shut the door. There were several operating tables in the room. On most were corpses covered with sheets. As heavy footsteps pounded the stairs, McDowell dove onto the table that had held the young girl's body only minutes before. He pulled the sheet over his face and tried not to breathe. The men came in with guns and lanterns. They uncovered one body. "It was that of a man," McDowell said. Then they came to two women with black hair. The girl they were looking for had flaxen hair. Then one of the men pulled back the sheet over Dr. McDowell. "Here's a fellow who died in his boots. I guess he's a fresh one." The doctor lay like stone. The man dropped the sheet back over his head. Moments later, the searchers left the room and hurried back down the stairs. McDowell waited until the coast was clear, then sprinted out a back door. He returned to the college the next morning and retrieved his prize from the attic. "We dissected the body," he said, "buried the fragments, and had no further trouble." Body snatching was dangerous business, but many doctors were willing to accept the risk for just the right specimen. "I was one of four who had agreed to exhume the body of a man in immense size," a doctor named Marmaduke Burr Wright recalled of one of his many memorable visits to the graveyards of Cincinnati. With picks, shovels, rope, and a large sack concealed under long coats, the men walked down dark roads to a cemetery behind a small church. Crouching in the building's dark shadows, they looked out at the graves. There was a problem. Lantern light still streamed from the windows of surrounding houses. The light bounced off the stone graves, giving the bone orchard an eerie gray glow. The men wrapped their jackets around themselves and waited. Over the next few hours, one by one, the lanterns went out. Then Dr. Wright's team got to work. One man guarded the front gate to the cemetery. Another stood near the back. Wright and the fourth man started shoveling up the loose dirt of a fresh grave. They quickly dug down to the bottom of a wooden coffin. Wright jumped into the hole, brushed away the dirt, and inspected the box. Thick wood, he saw, held together with quality screws. He slid one end of a pick under the lid and started working the handle back with quick jerks. The coffin lid bent and creaked, and crack! Wright froze. The sound of snapping wood seemed to bounce like thunder from house to house. Dogs started barking. Lights appeared in windows. Dim figures could be seen in the windows peering out. A very long minute passed. "Not a footstep, however, was heard approaching us," Wright remembered. free return to our labor. The doctor looped a rope around the dead man's chest and climbed out of the hole. He and the others heaved, backing up as they pulled, until the big body flopped up onto the grass. Two men slipped a sack over the corpse while the others gathered up the tools. Then the team hoisted the dead man onto their shoulders and left the cemetery. We had not gone far with our burden, recalled Wright, when, as we turned a corner, a man came suddenly upon us. The stranger came toward them, staggering and muttering. He was so drunk he passed by without seeing a thing. A bit further down the road, Wright and the crew spotted an old wheelbarrow by a shed. They dumped their load into it. The cart's rusty axle groaned and squeaked under the weight, but at least they could move faster. The men hurried toward their lab, where they could hide the body. Every step we took was attended with hazard, Wright said of the trip home. The sky was already lightening to a faint yellow. Smoke began rising from the chimneys of farmhouses along the road. The butcher drove past in his wagon. The group was in sight of their building when a man turned a corner, stopped, and blocked their path. Doctors, what have you there? He demanded. Wright and the others let go of the wheelbarrow and stepped back. The man looked over the strangely shaped sack. He opened the top a little and peered in. Confused, he reached in his hand and felt around and touched the cold flesh of a dead human face. The man shuddered, pulled out his hand, raised his arms high in the air, and ran screaming down the streets of Cincinnati. We seized this as the only favorable moment of escape, said Wright. Pushing the squeaking wheelbarrow through town, they reached Wright's lab, raced in, and locked the door behind them. Scenes like this continued until the late 1800s, when states began passing laws making it easier for doctors to legally acquire the bodies they needed for their studies. This destroyed the demand for stolen corpses, putting the ghouls out of business.